Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Burro Genius, a Memoir, by Victor Villaseñor, narrated by Robert Fass. The kingdom of God is within us all, Jesus Christ. What lies before us and what lies behind us are small matters compared to what lies within us. And when we bring what is within out into the world, miracles happen. Ralph Waldo Emerson. Burro, a small horse, a donkey, biblically called an ass, one of the older and most widely used animals for work and burden throughout much of the world. An animal used to breed with horses to get a mule, a larger, stronger beast of burden than a burro. Genius, guardian deity or spirit of a person. Spirit, natural ability. According to ancient Roman beliefs, a guardian spirit assigned to a person at birth. Tutelary deity, hence the guardian spirit of any person, place, etc. A person having great mental capacity or an inventive ability, especially great and original creative ability in art, science, etc. Preface. In the spring of 1962, I started writing this book. I was 22 years old. I'd been writing short stories for 2 years, so I figured that I was ready for the big book. I went through 6 different drafts of this book that first year, and I mailed out each draft to a publisher, but I only got rejected. The book became an obsession. With each rejection, I became more excited, because I'd now see how to rewrite the book and maybe, just maybe, make it a little bit better. I began to get up at 2 or 3 in the morning and work for 12 to 15 hours a day. I'd get so emotionally drained by the writing that I'd feel sick at the end of the day. My family became worried about me, and they invited a friend who was a writer in Los Angeles to see me. He told me that he'd heard how serious I was about my writing, so he was willing to take a little time off of his busy schedule to glance at my work. I gave him the latest version of my manuscript. He took it home and came back to see me the following week. His face was long. He told me that he was sorry to say this, but as a family friend, he had the obligation to be truthful, so he'd tell me straight out that I had no talent. The book was terrible. And also, I was trying to write way beyond my mental capabilities. He then explained to me that the world of writing was very competitive, and so it would be wrong for him to give me any encouragement. He told me that the best thing for me to do was quit writing, not waste any more of my young life, and take advantage of my father's business enterprises. I thanked him. I could see that he'd hated to say what he'd said to me. Then he said the strangest thing. He looked at me in the eyes and said, "You're not going to pay attention to anything I've just said, are you?" "No, I'm not," I said. He shook his head. I could see that he was really worried. A few months later, I went into the army. I took the last version of my manuscript with me. I tried to work on it while doing my military service. Getting back from overseas, I leaped back into the book again with what I'd learned overseas, writing at an insane pace for a few more years. Finally, I quit the book, took the tools that I'd developed as a writer, and wrote 3 other books, and also sent these to publishers. I only received more rejections. Then, I was almost 30 years old when I wrote Macho, and finally got published after 265 rejections. Immediately I returned to this book you're hearing, thinking I could now pull it off, but I was wrong. Over the next few decades, I sold other books, but I'd always return to this book. I accumulated more than 100 different drafts. I got married, became a national bestseller author, had 2 sons, but still, no matter how much I'd try to pull this book off, I just kept missing the mark, even though some publishers were saying that some parts of the book were beautiful. Then my father passed over to the other side, and my mother passed too, and somehow, with both of them now in the spirit world with my brother Joseph, the voice within me grew stronger, crystal clear, and I was now able to complete this book. Thank you. Gracias. It took me 40 years of wandering through the jungles of my mind, heart, and soul to finally realize this book. Enjoy. From mi familia to your familia. Book 1. Chapter 1. I'd been writing for 13 years, received over 260 rejections, and had just gotten, thank God, my first book published. The year was 1973. I was 33 years old in Long Beach, California, at a CATE conference, meaning California Association of Teachers of English. I was in the back room along with five other writers. All of the other authors had previous works published. We were waiting for the main speaker to show up. This writer wasn't only published like the rest of us. No, he'd had a bestseller, was a nationally recognized speaker, and was going to show up any minute and give the keynote address to the luncheon of the whole CATE convention. Karen, our publisher's publicist, was nervous as hell, pacing the room and trying to figure out what to do. The national best-selling author should have arrived at least 30 minutes ago. He was supposed to have flown in from the East Coast the night before on the red eye. Myself, I was pretty nervous too. I'd never been in a room with so many writers before. In fact, I'd never even met a published author until about 6 months back, and that was when I'd been in the Los Angeles office of my New York publisher, and I'd finally found out that yes, 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 I was really going to be published. I immediately called my mother and father, screaming to the high heavens. I'd been so excited. Phantom from New York was going to publish my book, Macho. The room we were in was small, but felt much larger because of all the excitement. I had no idea what was expected of me, so I stood in a corner by myself, playing it safe and just watching everything. Hell, the only reason I was even here was because our publicist, Karen Black, who was actually white, had called me up out of the blue yesterday afternoon, I guess as an afterthought, and said, "Don't you live just south of Long Beach?" "Yes, I do," I'd said. "Good. I hope you're not too busy or will take offense that I'm calling you so late, but you see, we're going to have several of our authors giving workshops at a CATE conference in Long Beach this weekend, so why don't you drive up the coast and join us?" "Cat? What's that?" I'd asked. "No, CATE, California Association of Teachers of English. They buy a lot of books. This conference is very important for us and could be for you too." "Oh, I see. Yeah, sure, I'll come," I said, taking a deep breath. "Will I be attending one of the workshops?" "We thought you might present a workshop." "Me?" "Yes, of course. You are a published author." My heart began pounding. What would I give a workshop on to English teachers? "On your experiences in writing. On that special English teacher who inspired you to become an author," she said, full of honey. "Bye now. We'll see you there. Don't worry, you have a creative mind. You'll come up with something." She gave me the address, and then this morning I drove in my white van up from Oceanside, where I still lived on the ranch on which I was raised, to Long Beach. I'd never heard of CATE in all my life, much less did I know what it meant to present a workshop. All I knew was that I'd flunked the third grade twice because I couldn't learn to read, had a terrible time all through grammar school and high school. Then, after 10 years of writing, I was finally able to sell my first book to a leading mass-market paperback publisher in New York. And now, standing in a corner, I felt pretty green. After all, these other writers in the room had been published before, and they were talking to one another like they were all best friends, swapping publishing stories, laughing happily, eating cookies and drinking coffee. I was drinking water. One sip of coffee would have shot me through the roof. Listening to the conversation around the snack table, I was beginning to understand that these other writers had not only already had several books published, but that most of their books had first come out in hardback, then had come out in mass-market paperback. I was quickly learning that it was not very prestigious for me to have first been published in paperback, because paperback books didn't get reviewed, and reviews were what got an author attention, respect, and sold books. Hell, I was still so wet behind the ears that I hadn't even realized what a review was until a few weeks back. So I said nothing and just kept listening closely, trying to learn all I could without showing my ignorance. Also, I could now see that these other writers were dressed more like city people. I guessed that it had been a mistake for me to come in Levi's, cowboy boots, a big belt buckle, a Western shirt, and my old blue blazer. Behind the closed doors of the next room, we could hear the low, rumbling noise of all the people at the conference eating lunch. I figured that it had to be a good-sized crowd of people by the sound of the ruckus of plates and conversation. Our publisher's publicist was now chain-smoking as she paced the room. Checking her watch for the umpteenth time, Karen now sent her assistant, Sandy, to check for any messages at the lobby, then told her to also go out to the parking lot and glance around. Boy, it was all like a movie. Here I was in the back room with a bunch of real writers, and any second now a nationally recognized author was going to come rushing down the hallway and lead us through the two closed doors where a whole convention of teachers was waiting to meet us. My heart was pounding a good million miles an hour with all the excitement. After all these years, I was really a published author, standing there eating carrot sticks right along with other published writers. Before this, all the writers I'd ever seen were on the back covers of books and on posters up on the walls in libraries and bookstores. I had to keep pinching myself to make sure that all this was really true. Every day for over 13 years, I'd been dreaming of something like this. Suddenly, Sandy came rushing back into the room, handing Karen a note. Our publicist glanced at the note, and it looked like she was going to scream, but she didn't, and gave a little curse instead. "Damn it," she said. "He didn't take the red eye. His plane has just landed. His limo driver says that he can't have him here for at least another 40 minutes. We can't keep this convention waiting any longer." Wow, this was all becoming more like a fast-paced movie by the moment, I thought. But then, the next thing I knew, Karen turned her attention to us, the writers, who were across the small beige-green room by the coffee table laid out with snacks. "Have any of you ever been a keynote speaker?" she asked. None of us answered. We just glanced at one another. Seeing our reaction, Karen crossed the room in large, confident steps. I could feel her determination. She was going to get something out of one of us, and immediately, too. "Look," she said to us in a calm and yet forceful voice, "behind those two green doors, we have a convention room full of English teachers. They've been patiently waiting for over 30 minutes. I need to give them a speaker in the next 5 minutes or less. Can any one of you handle this situation?" I glanced around at my fellow authors, and I couldn't believe it. Not one of these writers, who'd had hardcover books published and knew a hell of a lot more about what was going on than me, was coming forward. I took a deep breath, straightened up, picked up my Western hat off a chair, and stepped forward. "I can do it," I said in a loud, clear voice. She looked at me, saw my hat in my hand, which I was very proud of because my dad had given it to me, glanced at my shirt and jeans and down to my boots. "Which title is yours?" she asked. "Macho," I said. "It's about Chicanos, right?" "No, not really. It's about a young Mexican boy coming across the border without papers to the United—" "Chicanos, Mexicans, they're all just about the same, right?" "Well, yeah, in a way, except they're totally different, because one is born in the United States and the other is born in—"
"Have you ever spoken publicly before?"
"Well, no, not really. But I know I can do it, just like, well, I knew that I'd someday get published."
"And how long did that take you?"
I didn't appreciate the way she was looking at me. "Not very long," I said, lying. She turned away from me.
"Haven't any one of you other writers ever been a keynote speaker?" she asked.
The most smartly dressed writer among us, a woman who was probably, I guess, in her late 30s or early 40s, spoke up.
"I have," she said, "several times, but I was also given notice beforehand so I'd have time to prepare."
"Don't you have something prepared for your workshop?"
"Certainly, of course. But as I'm sure you realize, A workshop and a keynote address are very different, she said, raising her left eyebrow in one of the most dignified arches that I'd ever seen. Karen turned back to me. You do realize, she said, that public speaking is very different from writing. Few authors are good public speakers. One is done in private, and the other... Maybe we'd better just wait, she said, turning to her assistant, Sandy. I was beginning to like Karen less and less. Yeah, sure, she was good-looking and smartly dressed, too, and had probably been the top student in her class all through grammar school, high school, and college. But she just didn't seem very open-minded or flexible. I liked her assistant Sandy a lot better. She seemed softer, less judgmental, and more open. I guessed that Karen was single and in her mid-30s. Sandy, I bet, had a boyfriend and was in her late 20s and had had more than just straight A's going for her in school. Myself, I'd mostly been a C student, had wrestled, worked on the ranch, and now had a girlfriend to whom I'd recently proposed, but she'd turned me down. Also, I had such a baby face that until about 2 years ago, I was still ID'd regularly in most bars. Sandy quickly whispered something to Karen. Okay, okay, said our publicist. Great idea, good thinking. You, she said, turning back to me, come with me. But that hat has to go. And could we get him a different shirt? These are educated people. I closed my eyes so I could concentrate on the fact that, I guess, it had just been decided that I'd be the one to give the keynote address. So what I was wearing wasn't really the main issue. I followed Karen and Sandy down the hallway. But then I suddenly realized that I had to pee. This had also happened to me in high school when I'd been a wrestler. I'd get real nervous just before a match and have this terrible feeling that I needed to pee. Then I'd go to the bathroom and I couldn't pee for the life of me. But I was afraid to say anything about this to Karen and Sandy, so I just kept following the two women down the long, narrow hallway. Sandy kept whispering in Karen's ear and glancing back at me. I liked Sandy. She didn't just look at me like I was a head of lettuce that didn't fit in with the other heads of lettuce. I was able to catch the tail end of their conversation. Sandy was reminding Karen that this was the West Coast and not New York, so a Mexican-American writer might just fit in very well with this group of teachers, especially with all the daily news going on about Cesar Chavez and his field workers. All right, said Karen. Maybe it will work. But what happened to our backup speaker? You know that we always have to have a backup speaker when we do these big events. Sandy glanced at me. He's in the bar, she said to Karen. I just saw him. I don't think we can go with him. That's all we need, another drunk author. All right, then we'll go with this writer. But do we have anything on him? And who will introduce him?
I can do that, said Sandy, smiling at me. I just read his bio. It has legs.
Really? Said Karen, sounding impressed.
Yes.
All right, then he's our man of the hour. Then, I couldn't believe it, Karen now turned to me with a big smile, as if I'd really been her first choice all along, and said, How are you feeling? Is there anything we can do for you? I felt like saying, No thanks, madam, you've already kicked the crap out of me enough. But I didn't. Instead, I just said, No, I just need a bathroom, then I'm ready to go. Her face twisted.
Are you getting sick?
I had to take a big breath. No, I said, I just need to pee.
Oh, good. That's wonderful. You take him to the bathroom, Sandy, and I'll go tell them that we'll be ready to go on in 2 minutes. Is that long enough for you to, well, get ready? She asked me.
I nodded.
Yeah, sure. Good. Then hurry. This is an important keynote for us. A lot of teachers and entire school districts are going to know about you and your book in just a few minutes. Your English, I mean, you do speak proper English, I take it.
I decided not to tell her about my flunking the third grade twice. I also decided to not inform her that I was never able to get into regular lit classes in college because I could never pass remedial English. I turned on my heels. I'd just about taken all I could from her.
Please don't take what Karen says too seriously,
said Sandy to me as we quickly went down the hallway by the lobby to the restrooms.
She's really a very fine person once you get to know her. She's just under a lot of pressure. Being a publicist can be hell at times like this.
As we flew past the bar, I recognized the well-known science fiction writer at the bar, drinking and tossing down peanuts. At the door of the men's room, I abruptly stopped. Sandy was staying so close to me that I thought she might just come in with me.
"I'll wait for you right out here," she said. "And could you please give me your hat so you can comb your hair?"
I didn't want to, but I handed her my hat.
"You do have a comb, don't you?"
"Yes, I do," I said, feeling like I suddenly had a new mother.
"I'm sorry that we're being so pushy," she said, "but as you might guess, it can sometimes be very difficult handling writers."
I nodded and went inside. Immediately, I walked up to a stall and unbuttoned my Levi's. I always wore the old original buttonfly Levi's because of the short crotch. I have long legs for a man my height, but a short torso, so the newer Levi's with a zipper ride too high up on my waist. I couldn't pee, no matter how much I tried, and I really needed to go, too. Finally, I walked across the huge bathroom. I was all alone. I washed my hands in the sink, then washed my face with cold water. Then I remembered how this girl that I'd met up in San Francisco right after I'd gotten out of the army would always turn on the water in the sink when she went to pee. I'd thought that she did it because she didn't want anyone to hear her waterfall echoing in the toilet, but she'd explained to me that the sound of running water actually relaxed her so she could pee more easily. I decided to give it a try. I dried my hands and face, left the water running in the sink, recrossed the bathroom, and put myself in front of a stall once again. Closing my eyes and breathing real slowly, I was finally able to start peeing. And man, it just kept coming and coming, and it was still coming fast when the knocking started on the door. But I just ignored the knocking and kept on peeing. I mean, it was like I was never going to stop. Then, I couldn't believe it, someone opened the door.
"Are you okay?" said a woman's voice. It was Karen. "Everyone is waiting."
"Yes," I said, feeling irritated as hell.
"It's been 2 minutes, you know."
"Please," I said. "I'm busy. I'll be right out."
"You're not sick, are you?"
"No, I'm fine. Just shut the door, please."
She closed the door and I finished peeing, buttoned up, went back to the sink, washed my face with cold water again, then turned off the water. I wondered if she'd thought that the sound of the water from the faucet had been me peeing. I laughed. That was really funny. I took another couple of paper towels, dried my hands and face, then glanced into the mirror, saw my wide, high-cheekboned face, my straight black hair, took two or three deep breaths, just as I'd always done in high school before a wrestling match, then said in Spanish, not ever in English, "Papito Dios," meaning little daddy God, "please, Papito, you got to stick close to me right now. I need your help, no kidding. Gracias." Saying this, I quickly made the sign of the cross over myself, felt better, and knew that I was now as ready as I'd ever be, con el favor de Dios. Hell, my freshman year in high school, I'd made the varsity team, won 9 out of 12 matches, and I'd been wrestling against juniors and seniors, guys 2 and 3 years older than me. I felt if I could do that, I could do this, no problema. I turned and walked out of the bathroom. Both Karen and Sandy were waiting for me right outside of the door. Karen got hold of my arm. She was really strong. Quickly, she started walking me as fast as she could back across the lobby, then up the hallway towards the rear entrance of the convention center. I kept trying to get my hat back from Sandy, but Karen finally said, "Absolutely not. We'll keep it for you until after your talk." But I always wore hats. I'd learned this as a little kid from watching Beanie and Cecil, the sea serpent on kids' TV. Beanie had always put on his thinking hat before he did anything important. And my dad, who'd sometimes taken the time to watch the little kids' TV shows with me, had told me that he entirely agreed with Beanie 110%,
because he too always wore a hat when he played poker or had any important thinking to do. "Look, I want my hat," I said to Karen as we came to the end of the hallway.
"No,"
said Karen, taking my hat from Sandy and holding it behind herself. "I will not have one of our authors going out there with a ridiculous-looking old hat. It's bad enough that you're wearing that loud Western shirt and a big belt buckle. Don't you get it? You're a published author now. You're in the majors." I took a big breath. That did it. She'd just pushed one too many of my buttons. Women got to wear colorful clothes and even padded bras in the majors, didn't they? So why couldn't a guy wear a bright turquoise shirt and a big belt buckle? Hell, her bra was probably even padded. Sandy opened the door for us, and suddenly here I was, along with Karen and the five other authors, in a gigantic room that stretched out forever in all directions. The whole place was packed full of people sitting at large round tables, about 10 to a table. It looked like acres and acres of people, and you could see that they'd already eaten, were into their dessert and coffee, and were looking pretty antsy. I froze. This was one hell of a lot bigger affair than I'd ever imagined. Sandy immediately went to the microphone. She had a copy of my book, Macho, in hand. Glancing at the back cover, she began to read, introducing me to the audience. I glanced around. I really needed my dad's hat right now, at least in my hands. I glanced at Karen. She was smiling radiantly at the audience, and she now had my hat behind her shirt like she was trying to hide it from me. I took a big breath. She'd been treating me like a little kid ever since they'd walked me to the bathroom. Sandy was almost done with my introduction. She was now telling the crowd that I was one of their newly published authors. "He's written an excellent book called Macho, but it isn't really about machismo. It tells the story of a young Tarascan Indian boy who journeys from Michoacan, Mexico, to the United States and toils in the fields with Cesar Chavez." Everyone started clapping, including Karen, and in that split second, with her holding my hat in front of her body as she clapped, I leaped forward and snatched it from her, then turned on my heels and walked up to the mic before she could say or do anything. I was terror-stricken, but felt better now that I had my dad's hat with me. This was my padded bra with which to face the world. I put on the old sweat-stained Stetson and instantly felt better. Then I took hold of Sandy, who was handing me the microphone, and I gave her un abrazo, meaning a hug, wanting to thank her for her beautiful introduction. But I felt her tense her body and start to panic. Then, hearing my words of thanks in her ear, she relaxed and hugged me back. This felt good. I was set. I'd gotten to that calm, safe place inside of me that I'd needed to get to. She turned me around, but didn't hand me the mic. Instead, she slipped it into the metal gadget that was built into the top of the box-like podium, which was made of beautiful oak. I breathed. She'd been smart to do this. My hands were shaking too much for me to have handled the mic. But I wasn't really very worried. I'd had some of my best wrestling matches when I'd been this wound up. Sandy left my side, and now I was all alone, standing before one of the largest crowds of people that I'd ever seen assembled, except, of course, at the Del Mar racetrack. I had no idea what to do, much less where to begin. In the bathroom, I'd thought of maybe just opening up my book and reading to them about the Paricutin volcano in the state of Michoacán, Mexico, where my novel begins. But then I'd also remembered how all my life I'd had so much trouble reading, especially aloud, that this wouldn't be the best bet for me. Hell, by the time I'd gotten to the fifth grade, I was so gun-shy of reading aloud that I'd rather have had the teacher hit me with her ruler than put me through the embarrassment of all the kids finding out what a terrible reader I was. My head was beginning to get hot. I took off my hat, put it on the podium, and continued to look out at the crowd of mostly all Anglo people. There were only a few blacks scattered here and there. Nowhere did I see a wide brown face like mine. I took another big breath and decided to just talk, to simply tell them how I'd researched this book by interviewing some of the guys on our ranch, and then how I'd combined the story of one main guy with two other of our vaqueros. Then I'd explained that I'd found out that interviewing people didn't quite do it, so I'd then had to actually cross the border myself illegally at Mexicali, and working in the field picking melon from the border up through Bakersfield and then Fireball, the world capital del melón. Then, I don't know what exactly happened to me, but as I looked out at this sea of faces, and I realized that they were all English teachers, I suddenly felt my heart explode, but not with fear, no, with white-hot rage. And I now knew exactly what it was that I really wanted to say. I took in another deep breath. Some of these teachers were now getting up to leave, but this didn't frighten me, just as it hadn't frightened me to go into wrestling matches where I had seen that my opponent didn't have much respect for me. In some of those matches, I'd gone in with lightning speed, taken the older, more experienced guy by complete surprise, and pinned him within seconds. "Excuse me," I shouted, not realizing the microphone would amplify my voice into a thunderous sound. "But I understand that all of you here are English teachers." My booming voice stopped everyone in their tracks. I glanced at Karen and Sandy, who were over to the right of me, some 20 feet away. It looked like Karen was just about ready to shit a brick. I closed my eyes, got my publicists and everything else out of my head, and put myself astride a 1,000-pound horse, a lo charro chingón, 10 feet tall, faster and stronger than any human in all the world. Opening my eyes, I grabbed hold of the podium before me like I'd do to a calf in calf roping. "Once I had an English teacher," I said, feeling my heart leaping into my throat. People smiled, others laughed. And the ones who'd been getting up to leave now sat back down. "And to this day, I hope to God, with all my heart, that that English teacher dies a painful death that lasts at least 1 week, because, I barked into the microphone as I grabbed the podium with such force that I shook its heavy oak up and down. "I can forgive bad parents, because maybe it was an accident. Maybe they didn't even want to be parents. But teachers are no accident. You study to become a teacher. You work at it for years. So I cannot and will not forgive teachers who are abusive, mean, and torture kids with commas and periods and misspelling, making them feel like they are less than human because they don't or can't seem to get it right. But on the other hand, I pray to God with all my heart and soul that all good teachers who are patient, attentive, considerate, and kind go to heaven when they die, and they are rewarded with vanilla ice cream and apple pie for all eternity. Because, you see, a bad teacher, like Moses, the abusive English teacher that I had in Carlsbad, kills kids here in the heart, and not just with their tests, but with their superior attitude and those sly smiles that they like to give to their A students, but never to the ones who are also working hard, or maybe even harder, like me, but just couldn't get it. I was tortured by teachers. You hear me? Tortured! I yelled, jerking the whole podium off the floor. Hell, I flunked the third grade twice because... I was crying so hard that I had to wipe the tears out of my eyes with the back of my hand, but this wasn't going to stop me. I was all guts up front now. I was in that smooth-feeling, all-true place that I got into when I'd go to my room and start writing each morning before daybreak with all my heart and soul. "Truly," I shouted, "understand that this that I'm talking about is important. I wrote for 10 years before I got published. I'd written over 6 books, 65 short stories, and 4 plays, and received more than 260 rejections before I got published. And it was hate and rage towards abusive teachers that kept me going year after year, with the hope that one day I'd get published and have a voice so I could make a difference down here in our hearts and guts," I said, grabbing hold of my own gut. "Where we really live, if we're going to live a life worth living.
Because, you see, real teaching isn't just about teaching the brain up here, I said, hitting my forehead. But it's also about inspiring your students to have heart, compassion, guts, understanding, and hope. My grandmother, God bless her soul, a Yaqui Indian from northern Mexico, was the greatest teacher I'd ever had. And do you know what she taught me? She taught me that each and every day is un milagro given to us by God, and that work, that planting corn and squash with our two hands is holy. She taught me all this with kindness and invitation, not with ridicule and looking down her nose at me and making me feel like less than human when I didn't get it at first. I was crying so hard that I had to stop talking to catch my breath. Quickly, out of nowhere, Sandy was at my side, patting me on the back and handing me a glass of water. I drank the whole glass down. I suddenly had to pee again, but I figured that I could probably hold it, I hoped. "Are you okay?" asked Sandy, stroking my arm. "Can you go on?" I closed my eyes and took a deep breath. "Yes," I said, feeling my heart beating like a mighty drum. "I can go on. I got to," I added. My grandmother was here at my side. I could feel, see, sense her completely.
"Okay," said Sandy. "You're doing fine. This isn't exactly what they were expecting, but you do have their attention."
I almost laughed. Sandy was right. Looking out at the crowd, I could see that I really did have everyone's attention. In fact, some were at the edge of their seats, ready to take in my every word. But others were shaking their heads and looking like they wanted to get up and leave. I glanced at Karen, who looked like she'd already shit her brick, and she was now running her index finger across her throat. I guessed that she was telling me that she was going to cut my throat once she got hold of me. I only laughed at her, too. Hell, there was no way on earth that I was now going to be silenced. I'd been holding back all this fire inside me ever since I'd started school. A whole bunch of people towards the back of the room were now getting up to leave, but these teachers were not going to intimidate me. I wasn't my father's and mother's son for nada, nothing. I wasn't my two indigenous grandmother's grandson for nada, nothing either. I came from a long line of people who'd lived through starvation, revolutions, and massacre. "And you," I yelled into the microphone, "over there in the back, who are getting up to leave, I'm glad that you're leaving, because obviously you're those bad teachers that I'm talking about. Hell, if you were good teachers, you'd be happy with what I'm saying." 3/4 of the teachers who'd been getting up to leave suddenly sat back down. I loved it. I was finally kicking ass after all these years of getting my own ass kicked. "When I started school," I continued, "I spoke no English, Spanish only. And we weren't invited in to learn English in a nice civilized way. No, we were screamed at. No joke, yelled at. No Spanish, English only. And then ridiculed, called names, and hit on the head or slapped across the face if we were ever caught speaking Spanish. And Spanish was all I knew. And on that first day of kindergarten, I needed to go to the bathroom, but the teacher yelled no. So I peed all over myself, with pee running down my legs until it formed a puddle by my shoes. And all the kids sitting close to me looked at me in disgust, holding their noses. Then at recess, they let me have it with ridicule. That's not right. Teachers and their arrogant ways pit us kids against each other. A students against all other kids. B students feeling good that they're not C and D students. Confrontation and war is what you teachers start instilling in kids from kindergarten on. We need to study history so we don't repeat it. It's a bunch of bull. Don't you get it?" I said, wiping my eyes. "We keep repeating history because that's what you teach. Meanness, greed, and every man and woman out for themselves without mercy." Now 2 whole tables of teachers got up and started to leave. "Sit down," I barked. "You're not dismissed.
Class is still in session. Hell, I'm just getting started. You came to hear a writer talk, and now, by God, you're going to hear a writer speak. I will not sit down and listen to any more insults, yelled one teacher to me from about one-third back in the room. You're just a spoiled, overpaid author, and all of us here are underpaid and overworked teachers, every day working above and beyond duty. I got $4,500 for my book that just got published, I said. It took me over 3 years to write it. After my agent's fee, that's less than $1,500 a year. I'm not complaining and saying that I'm underpaid. I'm happy, big happy, that I got published. I think it's an honor to be a writer, just as it is an honor to be a teacher, a person who can... You just speak generalities. You're not telling us anything specific, she yelled, cutting me off. You want something specific, I said. Well, I specifically don't like you. Because if you had any heart and didn't feel so guilty for being one of these abusive teachers, you wouldn't take offense at what I'm saying. So go, leave, you and all your other offended teachers. A couple of teachers applauded me, a few tables away from the people who were leaving. But the teacher who spoke and about a dozen other teachers left with a big ruckus, taking their book bags, coats, and purses. Well, about 90% of all the other teachers stayed, and when I was through with my talk, about 30 minutes later, a good third of them were also wiping their eyes. When I closed, I got a standing ovation of such volume and magnitude that the walls of the huge room actually vibrated. Teachers rushed to me. Karen and Sandy had to pull people away from me so that they could take me to our booth down the hall into another huge room so I could sign books. The number of people who got in line to have me sign my book was so long that it dwarfed the lines of all the other writers. And this room was full of other top-name New York publishers with their own writers, too. Teachers kept asking me if I could come to their schools to give a talk, that I'd been so real, and reality was what their students needed above all else. Others asked if I'd written any books on education. I said no, not yet, that Macho was my first book. And Karen, she now couldn't do enough for me. She kept bringing me water, snacks to eat, stroking me on the arm and shoulder, and asking me if I needed anything to give me the strength to keep autographing books. I signed books for well over 3 hours. And Sandy, when I was done, came up and gave me a big abrazo, hug, kissing me on the cheek. I just knew you could do it, she said, beaming. After reading your bio, I just knew that anyone who'd gone through so much for so long to get published had to have a floodgate holding back all that you needed to say. You did great. In fact, we ran out of your books, and the LA Times and the Long Beach newspaper are here to interview you. You mean my book is going to get reviewed? I asked all excitedly. Yes, that too, I'm sure. But right now they're here to do a feature story on you. That's even better than a review. It will reach people beyond those who read the book review section. You're on your way, she added. Congratulations, she said, hugging me once again. Boy, oh boy, I was flying. The two interviews were done in the lobby, and I had my photo taken too. Then, that evening, I was alone in the bar of our hotel having a beer when a man came up to me and said, Are you the writer who told Gladys Marsh that you specifically didn't like her in front of the whole convention? I didn't know what to say. I was exhausted, really tired. And this man looked like a pretty physical type guy in his 40s who probably had played football and still lifted weights. And hell, he might also just happen to be that woman's best friend or husband. But what the hell? I'd done what I'd done, and so there was no backing down now. I got off my bar stool so he couldn't take a swing at me while I was a sitting duck. Yes, I said, taking up ground. I did say that to a woman teacher, but I don't know if her name is Gladys whatever you said or not. His powerful-looking face suddenly broke into a huge grin, and he put out his right hand. Let me shake your hand and buy you a beer. Hell, I'm part of the teachers' union, and that woman is one of the most self-centered, abusive people I've ever had the misfortune of meeting. Always complaining about her paycheck and long hours, but never having any suggestions for helping the kids or improving the system. We shook hands, and he pat me real hard on the back.
Great job, he said. Great job. But tell me, why is it we've never heard of you before?
Obviously, you're a gifted speaker and writer from everything that I've been hearing from everyone who heard you speak and is now reading your book. And it was true. All afternoon and evening, I'd been seeing people here and there reading my book. And they'd tell me that my book was excellent and that I'd given the best talk that they'd heard in years. My God, what a great feeling this was after so many years of rejection. Man, so much had happened to me since I'd driven up this morning from Oceanside. Suddenly, I felt completely drained.
I'd like to take a rain check on that beer, if you don't mind, I said. It's been a big day for me. I need to go to my room.
Okay, he said, grinning. Have a good rest. I just wanted to shake the hand of the man who finally spoke up to that ball buster. Hell, I've known Gladys for 15 years, and no one has ever had the guts to put her in her place.
Good night, I said.
Good night, he answered. But I have one question to ask you, he added. Did you really have 260 rejections before you were published, or was that a publicity stunt? I took a deep breath.
No, I said. It's no stunt. It's real.
He looked at me in silence for a long time, then said, But surely there must have been at least one teacher who helped you along the way. It couldn't have all been negative. I took in another deep breath, thought a moment, then shrugged. He nodded.
Okay, but think about what I said, he said. And before your next talk, because I'm sure you are going to become a frequent speaker on the circuit, the way people are responding to you, it would help us immensely if you could also tell us about any good experiences that you might have had. Wake-up talks are good, but we also need to know about those teachers who had a constructive influence on you. Believe me, most of my teachers are smart enough and honest enough to admit what's wrong with our system, so we also need to know what works.
Congratulations, he said, extending his hand out to me again. I admire your perseverance, and if you could tell us how you acquired this perseverance, that in itself would help us tremendously. I nodded. I could see that this man was absolutely right. What I'd given was a wake-up talk, and there was a lot more that I still needed to learn, not just about public speaking, but writing too. But my God, my wounds were all still so fresh that it was very hard for me to remember any good experiences that I might have ever had at school.
Thank you, I said to him, and I left the bar and started across the lobby. I was feeling pretty woozy. It was a good thing that I'd accepted the hotel room that Karen had offered me. I could never have made it home. I just didn't know what had come over me when I'd looked out at that sea of English teachers. It was like my heart and soul had leaped forward with so much hate and rage that I'd instantly wanted to kill, to scalp, to massacre. And I'd been fearless, completely trusting my instincts, just like I did when I wrote. It was truly a good thing that I'd found writing as my outlet, or I was sure I would have become a mass murderer, killing all those heartless, racist teachers who'd beat us Mexican kids down since kindergarten, with the complete blessing of our one-sided, dark ages educational system. Shit, by the third grade I'd been so terror-stricken of school that I'd become a regular bedwetter. I thanked me mama that she'd known how to put me to bed with prayer and song, and that she'd bought a rubber mat to put over my mattress, giving me enough hope and encouragement so I could go on. And I thanked me papa, who'd always said to me that we, los indios, the Indians, were like the weeds, that roses you had to water and give fertilizer or they'd die. But weeds, indigenous plants, you gave them nada, nothing. Hell, you even poisoned them and put concrete over them, and those weeds would still break the concrete, reaching for the sunlight of God. That's the power of our people, my father would tell me. We're the weeds, las hierbas de todo el mundo, By the time I'd crossed the lobby and gotten in the elevator, I was so tired I was ready to drop. Hell, I'd never spoken in public before. I hadn't been on the debate team in school. Wow, I'd never had any idea that public speaking could be so tough. In my room, I undressed, cracked open the window, got in bed, and thanked Papito Dios for having gifted me another wonderful day in Paraíso. This was also what my old Yaqui Indian grandmother, Doña Guadalupe, had taught me to do each night, to give thanks to God at the end of each day, for every day was, indeed, a paradise given to us by the Almighty. Stardust was what we humans really were, my old grandmother had always explained to me, coming to this planeta as walking stars, just as Jesus had come to do Papito Dios's will on this tierra firma. I went to sleep feeling very good because I knew that I'd done my best with all my heart and soul. I didn't feel the least bit bad about how I'd gotten in those teachers' faces and told them what I really thought. After all, hadn't Jesus gotten mad at the moneylenders on the temple steps? But also, I could now understand very clearly that that man from the teachers' union had been right, and there was still a lot that I had to learn. Who were those school teachers who had helped me? And what was it in my life that had given me the heart, the guts, to go on and never give up, no matter what? Chapter 2. Dreaming, I slept in my large, spacious hotel room, dreaming of all the different waters that had gone slipping, sliding under the bridge on which I'd been living mi vida. A bridge bridging my Indian and European roots, a bridge bridging my Mexican and American cultures, a bridge bridging my indigenous beliefs and Catholic Christian upbringing, a bridge bridging my first few years of life in the barrio, and then my life on our Rancho Grande, and then that whole big world outside of our gates. I slept, feeling so warm and snug underneath the covers of the big hotel bed in Long Beach, the Pacific Ocean slapping the seashore quietly in the near distance as I dreamed, remembering back, like in a faraway, foggy dream, that yes, there really had once been a very special teacher who'd helped me along my way. He'd been a substitute teacher, and he'd only been with us for 2 or 3 days, but my God, he'd touched my very soul in that short time. I now remembered very clearly that I'd been in the 7th grade. I'd been going to the Army-Navy Academy in Carlsbad, California, about 4 miles south of our Rancho Grande. Originally, I'd started school in Oceanside, in an old public grammar school that no longer exists. This school had been located just west of the present Oceanside High School. For 5 years, I went to public school, but I'd been having such a difficult time that my mother had finally spoken to our priest, and it was decided that I'd be sent to Catholic school, thinking that I'd get more personal attention. But it hadn't helped. By the 6th grade, I was still 2 grade levels behind in reading. This was when it was suggested to my parents, by our insurance broker, Jack Thill, that I should be put in our local military school, where I'd be taught discipline, and with enough discipline, I would surely learn to read. On my first day of military school, I was terror-stricken. My older brother Joseph, who died when I was 9 years old, had gone to this school, and my parents told me that Joseph had loved it, but I didn't believe them, because within the first few minutes of my first day, I was already in deep trouble. Living in Southern California, I'd never worn woolen clothes before. My uniform was made of wool and made me itch so much that I couldn't stand still when they told us to line up, stand at attention, keep our eyes to the front, and stop fidgeting. And my God, I'd thought the nuns were bad where I'd gone to parochial school for 3 years, but this military school was far worse. A fellow cadet, not much older than me, put his face in my face and yelled at me to stop fidgeting, that I wasn't a girl, that I was now a cadet of the Army-Navy Academy, and that I had to stand up tall, pull my shoulders back, keep my eyes to the front, and keep still. I was so terrified that I was ready to pee. I was short, so how could I ever stand up tall? and my uniform was making my skin itch so much that I couldn't for the life of me stop fidgeting. Still, my fellow cadet continued to shout at me right in my face, and his mouth was huge and full of big white teeth. Within days, I came to realize that this was how cadets got promoted into being corporals and sergeants, by intimidating us other cadets with their in-your-face shouting. I also came to realize that these cadets, that the school officials put in charge of us new recruits, truly enjoyed their power. In fact, I could now see that some of them had the same little sneaky smiles on their faces when they shouted at us that I'd seen on the meanest public school teachers and Catholic nuns. My mother saved me again, just as she had saved me when she'd bought that rubber mat and put it on my bed so I wouldn't ruin another mattress. She bought some silky material when I told her about my uniform itching, and she hand-sewed the silky material into the back and front of my shirt and the thighs of my pants. I loved me mama, and she promised to never tell anyone about the baby blue material that she'd sewed into my uniform, just as she'd promised to never tell anyone about the rubber mat that was on my bed. I'd been going to the Army-Navy Academy for about 6 months, and this morning when I arrived, I figured that it was all going to be the same old routine until we were assembled, lined up, and marched into English class. Our regular English teacher, Captain Moses, wasn't present. At the front of our room was a man we'd never seen before. He wasn't in uniform. He wore regular civilian clothes, and he was short and blonde, looked very muscular, and had a huge smile.
"Good morning," he said to us in a big, happy-sounding voice.
After we took our seats, he pointed to a large poster that he'd pinned on the wall of someone skiing in the mountains.
"My name is Mr. Swift, and I'm your substitute teacher," he said. "Mr. Moses, from what I understand, is homesick. My wife and I are from Colorado, where we were ski bums. That's why we're substitute teachers. We moved to Southern California earlier this year to become surf bums. And this is why we will continue to be substitute teachers. I met my wife, Jody, at the University of Boulder at Boulder, Colorado. She was a track star. I bet that even today she could give your best sprinters at this school a run for their money in the 100-yard dash. I've never been able to beat her, and I'm pretty fast myself."
Smiling one of the biggest smiles that I'd ever seen, he now glanced around the classroom, giving each of us personal acknowledgement. This teacher seemed so different from all of our other teachers. He didn't look tired. He just seemed to be bursting with vitality and happiness. "Jody and I were married," he said, sitting on the front part of his desk, "right after college. We both love sports. In Colorado, we loved skiing, and here in Southern California, we love to get up at daybreak and hit the surf before coming to school. There's no feeling in all the world like coming down a slope in the Rockies, going 40, 50 miles an hour, except for feeling the wind and spray flying past your face when you catch a good wave. We both love speed. We plan to build a sailboat with our own hands, have 2.5 children, and sail around the world." Some of us screeched. This was so funny. He and his wife were going to have 2.5 kids. But I could also see that not all of us were laughing. Some kids didn't know what to make of him.
"There," he said, grinning to us from cheek to cheek. "In a nutshell, I've just shared with you what I love to do. Now I want you to share with me what you love to do," he said, getting to his feet. "And I don't care about spelling and punctuation. What my wife and I found out when we were ski instructors in Colorado was that the most important thing was to get our students on the slopes and get them all excited about skiing. Technique, we found out, comes later. Fun and excitement come first. Then people learn 100 times faster. Get it? It's not normal or healthy to keep energetic young kids like you closed up in a classroom. By nature, you want to play and run and jump and have fun. So that's why I don't care about periods or commas or misspellings at this time, even though this is English class. What I want to do is to get you so excited about reading and writing that the love of learning will be with you for the rest of your lives. I don't want to hinder your natural joy of wanting to venture into a world of books and writing and wanting to learn.
He stopped and looked around at all of us.
Who likes what I've just said? He now asked with a big grin.
I shot my hand up, and I thought that everyone else had shot up theirs. But I was wrong. A few cadets didn't raise their hands.
All right, he said. For you that don't feel comfortable with this method of teaching, I'll keep you off the slope and grade your papers for grammar and punctuation, too, he added.
I found this very interesting. The cadets who hadn't put up their hands were our three regular A students and one of our C students. Myself, I was mostly a D student, but I also got some C's and C pluses now and then.
All right, he said, start writing. And I repeat that the key point is, I shared with you what it is that I love to do, so now I want you to share with me what it is that you love to do. And I don't care about what it is. It can be about anything. All I want is to be able to feel the excitement of what it is that you love to do, he added with such vigor that I thought he would burst.
Hearing that I didn't have to worry about misspellings and punctuation marks, I was given wings. My God, I'd never heard a teacher call himself a bum before, and then share with us stories about his own life with such passion. Quickly, I started writing about what it was that I had always liked to do the most when I'd been a kid. It was going horseback riding in the hills behind our home, taking my trusty Red Ryder BB gun or my big, tall bows and arrows so I could hunt squirrels and rabbits. But I could see that some of my fellow cadets didn't start writing right away. One of them wanted to know how much time we had. Another wanted to know how long our papers should be. Mr. Swift told us that we had the whole session to write, and our papers could be 2 to 10 pages long, that he'd collect our work at the end of the period, grade them tonight, and give them back to us tomorrow. Our top A student, Walrick, who also happened to be our class leader, wanted to know if we'd get higher grades if our papers were closer to 10 pages than 2.
Yes and no, said Mr. Swift. I'll be grading on quality first, but quantity will also influence me. 100-yard dash, like my wife used to run, is a thing of beauty, but a full marathon is, he added, shaking his head, beyond belief.
They continued talking, but I was already writing, so I didn't pay much attention to them anymore. I then began to write about my big older brother Joseph, who we'd always called Jose or Chava Boy in Spanish at home, and I wrote that he'd died when I was in the 3rd grade. That was the first time that I flunked a grade. Finally, I heard our substitute instructor tell Walrick, who continued asking questions, that discussion wasn't always a sign of an inquisitive mind, but could also be interpreted as procrastination. Then he told us to all get started right now. I was on fire. I was already into my 2nd page. My God, without the shackles of spelling and punctuation, I was flying. All these things were coming out of me. Now I was writing about how my big brother Joseph had been sick and in the hospital for a long time before he'd died. My parents were gone a lot of the time, visiting him down at Scripps Hospital in La Jolla, and so I was very happy that my brother's dog Shep had started to spend a lot more time with me. Because, you see, dogs, like cats and horses, wouldn't spend time with you unless they really liked you. I'd been 8 years old at this time, I wrote, and in the 3rd grade, and every afternoon after school I'd go hunting with my bow and arrow and my brother Joseph's dog, Shep. Shep had been on the ranch when we'd moved from the barrio of Carlsbad to South Oceanside. Shep wasn't very big. He was half coyote and half sheepdog. And when we'd go hunting behind our ranch up the railroad tracks that ran inland from Oceanside to Vista, Shep never chased the rabbits or the squirrels like other dogs. No, he'd watch which way the squirrels or rabbits were headed. Then he'd race around, circling them real fast, beating a few of them to their holes. And those that didn't make it to their holes, he'd chase up a tree or fence post. Then, I saw him do this hundreds of times, Shep would get under the old tree or fence post, make eye contact with the squirrel. Then he'd begin to circle with his tongue hanging out, salivating.
That squirrel up in the tree or on a fence post would get so nervous watching him circle about below that he'd turn around and around, trying to keep his eyes on Shep. Then suddenly, Shep would change his direction and run really fast around the tree or fence post in the opposite direction, and that old squirrel would now get so dizzy that he'd fall out of the tree or off the fence post. Instantly, Shep would be on that squirrel, expertly grabbing him by the back of the neck and giving him one or two shakes with such force that he'd break the squirrel's neck, killing him. Every time we'd go hunting, Shep would get more squirrels than I could with my BB gun or bow and arrows. In fact, if the truth be told, my BB gun was so weak that the BBs wouldn't even penetrate the skin of a rabbit or squirrel unless I was super close. And with my big long bow, I was still so slow and clumsy that when I was in the third grade, I never got any game. I then concluded my paper by saying that for months I'd hunted with my brother's dog Shep before and after school, but then when my brother died, Shep ran off into the hills, never to be seen again. I couldn't believe it. I'd handwritten 9.5 pages. Boy, I'd been flying down that slope at 100 miles an hour. But I didn't want to stop, even though class was over and Mr. Swift was now collecting our papers. I still wanted to tell our teacher about how the Indian people who'd worked on the ranch for us had explained to me that Shep, who'd always loved my brother more than life itself, had disappeared because he'd run off to the highest hilltop to intercept my brother's soul so he could lead my brother's soul back to heaven. Dogs, cats, horses, all animals could do this at will much easier than us humans, Rosa and her husband Emilio had explained to me, because animals were much closer to God than we humans were. This was why Jesus had been born in a manger, to learn about love from the animals in the barn so that he could then do his most holy earthly work when he got big. I turned in my story, entitling it, "The Smartest Human I Ever Met, My Brother's Dog, Shep." And the next day, when I got my paper back, I had an A. Instantly, I knew that there was something really wrong with this substitute teacher. I'd never gotten an A in all of my life, so I took Mr. Swift aside to speak to him so he wouldn't get in trouble. "Look," I said to him, "you might know a lot about going down cliffs of snow and surfing, sir, but I don't think that you know too much about teaching."
"Why do you say that?" he asked.
My heart was pounding like a mighty drum. I knew that I'd be cutting my own throat by saying what I was going to say, but I had to. I didn't want Mr. Swift to get in trouble. I liked him. I really did. "Because, you see, sir," I said, my corazón beating, "I'm a Mexican, and so you can't be giving me an A. You've got to give me a D or C, or maybe you can get away with giving me a C+. Tears burst forth from my eyes. "Because I've had a few of those, but you can't," I added, feeling so tight in my chest that I could barely breathe, "give me an A. That's wrong, sir." He looked at me like he didn't know what I was talking about, took a deep breath, and gently put his hand on my shoulder. "I don't know what you're talking about," he said. "All I know is that I never saw animals as being so smart and special until I read your story."
"Really?"
"Yes, really. And I'm now also convinced that your brother's dog, Shep, is the smartest human I've ever met. Tell me, is it part of your Indian upbringing to refer to animals as being human?" he asked. I shrugged. I didn't know how to answer his question. It was still very hard for me to sometimes know where my Catholic Christian upbringing stopped and my grandmother's Indian teachings began. For me, it was all like one big river running together with all these different waters. By the time our local San Luis Rey River got to the sea, who could tell which water had come out of which canyon, especially when you realized that the San Luis Rey River didn't just start at our towering Palomar Mountain some 30 miles inland, but actually started beyond Palomar in all that huge open eastern country where my dad and my Uncle Archie liked to go deer hunting with Archie's relatives from the Pala Indian Reservation. "Okay, you don't need to know," he said. "Just keep writing as pure and honest as you wrote yesterday. I'm looking forward to reading what you'll write today. The A remains." I was double, triple, quadruple shocked. I'd never had an A in all my life.
My heart was beating a million miles an hour. I wrote that day in classes I'd never written before, expanding on the story that I'd written about Shep and how on the night of my brother's death, Shep had howled all night long at the moon, and then he'd disappeared in the early morning hours of the night. Then I wrote that when our dad and mom came home that morning from Scripps Hospital in La Jolla and informed my little sister Linda and me that our brother Joseph had died, we weren't surprised, because Rosa and her husband Emilio had already told us. I began crying as I wrote. Mr. Swift came by and stroked me on the shoulder when he saw me crying. Class was over, but I'd been so far away in my writing that I hadn't even realized that class was over, and the rest of the cadets were getting up so we could be marched to our next class. My God, Mr. Swift had been right. Once we got out of the confines of spelling and punctuation, writing and reading could be so exciting. Sleeping, dreaming here in my hotel room in Long Beach, I remembered all this like it had happened in a faraway, foggy dream. My God, I really hadn't realized it, but I owed so much of my joy of reading and writing to that substitute teacher in the seventh grade who, in 3 tiny days, had touched my heart and soul. My eyes filled with tears. My God, how I'd like to find that teacher and give him a copy of my book, Macho. I breathed and breathed again. Teaching didn't have to be long and boring and laborious. No, teaching could be done as fast as a lightning.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.